Hello aspirants, welcome back to the daily news analysis of The Hindu. This is a free initiative brought to you by Transform IAS Academy. In this video session, we shall be looking into the articles which shall be extremely important for the civil service exam perspective for the prelims and mains. So let's begin with our discussion for 31st of December 2018, so the last working day of 2018. So under the front page, we have this news which talks on the triple talaq bill likely to face the stiff resistance in Rajya Sabha. So this news is purely with respect to the triple talaq bill which was being passed by the Lok Sabha. So now it is moved on to the Rajya Sabha, and they're saying that it is actually facing a lot of restrictions with respect to the Rajya Sabha, which is a second attempt of the passage of the triple talaq bill. So here the opposition parties are actually making a lot of issues with respect to this particular bill, and to whatever the Lok Sabha has been passed through an amendment the past week. So this is the house which has to give the approval for the same. So here what they're saying is that this particular bill, which has been getting disapproved, they're saying that the Muslim Women Protection of Rights on the Marriage Ordinance 2018, it is promulgated by the President of India on 19th of September 2018, which has been subjected to disapproving. So this is basically the opposition party members and also the members along with that, they're not ready to have a proper upliftment of this particular triple talaq bill. So here you can actually see the distributions of the Rajya Sabha. So you know that Lok Sabha and Rajya Sabha, so Lok Sabha is a dissolution subjected to body, wherein the Rajya Sabha is a permanent body. So here the number of people who are already being present is 245. So out of 245, 73 seats are being allotted for the BJP, 50 for the Congress, AD-ADMK is 13, Trinamool Congress is 13, and SP is 13, BJD is 9, wherein others are 73. So now this is also facing a lot of strong opposition is what they're saying. So here they're also talking about the bill which has actually been addressed some of the concerns earlierly. So even as I told you, this is a second attempt to what they would be passing. In the first attempt also, the Rajya Sabha had asked for certain, you know, kinds of an addressing of the issues. And one such thing which should be highlighted here is that there was a provision which was being added where an husband who has been called as an accused, where he would be getting a bail from a magistrate. So this was something in addition which was being done. So but now is again they're saying that this particular bill should be taken for further examination. So they're again questioned on the provisions which actually making the criminalization of a civil wrong. So this is something, a marriage issue, something which is related to the civil subject. How can you criminalize that is what the complete issue is all about. So you need to know about the triple talaq. If you are a beginner, you need to know what is this bill is all about and what are the agencies which will actually be taking care of it. So the Rajya Sabha as of now, it's been actually denying to give the approval on basis of, you know, it is just a civil procedure. How can it come under criminalization? So this is about it. So one should know deeper when it comes to these kinds of appeal. And this one is a political issue where PM Sheikh Hasina has get for a landslide win in Bangladesh. So you can just skip this. So on the page 7, this is a very minute news. If you see here, it's HIV plus youth whose blood was transfused to women and dies. So this is with respect to in the government Rajaji Hospital, where a woman was actually given a blood, and the person who gave a blood, who was 19-year-old donor, he had the HIV positive. So on limelight of it, the woman died, and again this person also committed the suicide. So from here there's nothing much, but in the editorial you have the details, and the editorial has spoken about the HIV positive on what are the track records that need to actually be focused on. So that becomes important for us. So this is a minute news, just go through the editorial, that would be sufficient. So on the page 11 we have this hard lessons, the funds not enough to attract the teachers to government schools. So this is basically with respect to the state government which has have increased the budgets for the school education in the past 3 years. If you see here, the state governments, they've actually induced more of funds into the school education. So this is taking the records of our nearly past 3 years, but here what they're saying is that to whatever the fund allotment is being done, they are not enough to attract the permanent qualified teaching staff to the government schools. So two issues to what you have to know. One is that the state government has increased the budgets, but secondly, they are not able to attract a permanent qualified teachers. They have, having no teachers is what has become a problem to the government institutions. So this particular report was actually being prepared jointly by the CRY and the CBGA. That is the Child Rights and You and the Center for the Budget and the Governance Accountability. So these are the ones who are actually bought this report, and here they have examined the budgeting for the school's education in 6 states. And those 6 states are West Bengal, Chhattisgarh, Tamil Nadu, UP, Bihar and Maharashtra. And this is purely on the recommendation to what has been coming from the 14th Finance Commission, which was being started from the April 2015. So here the study also tells that the overall increase in the revenue with the states following the 14th recommendation was purely with respect to increasing a divisible pool from the state taxes, from that's a central taxes, from 32% to 42%. So this is very important. You should know that now the states would be getting a certain amount of the amount from the center to what the center raises through the taxes has got increased from 32% to 42%. But again, you have to know that here the studies are also analyzing whether the availability of these additional funds are really being translated into a prioritizing social education in these 6 states. What is a drawback actually all about? And moreover, between 2015 and 16 and 2017 and 18, there was a net decline. And this decline is purely with respect to the share of the school education budget in the total state budget for 3 of the 6 states. That is purely of the 3 of the 6 states. So here they are able to understand, and they wanted to know in detail, like, how are these demands for the grants and state budget documents are actually being given. And the percentages have been listed out here, where the Bihar has seen a dip of nearly 3.1%. The Maharashtra has seen a dip of almost 1%. West Bengal was 0.9%. Wherein the other end, that is Chhattisgarh, Tamil Nadu and UP, they have saw an increase in the size of the school education budget from 0.4%, 2.6% and 3.2% respectively. So basically, the report will start further examining whether these particular increase in the size of the school education was more better than in the size of the total budgeting part. So this is something where they have to look on for. But despite wearing a commitment towards what they're given for the school education across the 6 states, they also tell that there was a struggle with the shortage of the teachers. And this shortage of the teachers has actually made the things to look more pathetic, though there is an allotment of the funds which has actually been seen. So here you can see here the vacancies in the elementary schools in the 6 states as percentage of the sanctioned post and the percentage of the share of teachers' salaries in the total school education budget. So the 6 states have been mentioned out here, the sanctioned post have been mentioned out here, vacancies are here, and the vacancies as percentage of the sanctions post of 2017. So here shows about the details, wherein this is about the state levels. So they're showing about the 2014 to 2018 on the 4-year basis, how was the trend actually being seen. So the report also was talking with respect to the Union Ministry of the Human Resource Development, that is the HRD, where they're stating that by the March 2017, the West Bengal, Chhattisgarh, UP and Bihar, they have seen from 19% to 34% of the total teacher positions at the elementary level, which was purely vacant. But when it comes to the Maharashtra, Tamil Nadu, they were completely with having a relative between 5.9% and 2.6%, where the posts were completely not filled at all. So here the problem is that the vacancies of the teachers, which has been an alarming issue, and the single teacher, and here you have the coverage which talks on more than 1 lakh schools in India run with only one teacher, and all the 6 states surveyed have gone the number of such schools on the rise. The shortage of the teachers is still more acute at the secondary level. Bihar has just 20,494 teaching post vacant, where in Chhattisgarh it is having as more as 8,278 and UP with 12,008. So the figures to what they are showing is showing the severity in the shortfall and purely the, you know, shortage in the subject teachers as well. So they're not having a proliferations and the subject expert teachers in the government schools. So this shows the true and the reality behind the government schools, which they're actually facing a problem though the funds have been increased, but the attractions of the teachers have never been met. So this is a problem with the government schools. So this is about it. And here again, you have the coverage which talks on the Ross Highland is now a Netaji Dweep. So this is purely with respect to Mr. Subhash Chandra, I mean Netaji, where on 1943, Mr. Bose had actually suggested that the Andaman and Nicobar Highlands, they have to be renamed as Shahid and Swaraj Deep. So on lamlet of it is what Mr. Modi, Mr. Prime Minister of India, is actually releasing a commemorative stamp, and that is purely for the first day cover and a 75 rupees coin as well. So this is purely to setting up a deemed university which would be named after the Bose as well. So here what Mr. Modi is trying to do is that he is actually announcing the renaming of three highlands of Andaman and Nicobar. So this is purely to give a tribute to Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose. So the Rose Island wall, year after it will be called or renamed as Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose Dweep, wherein the Neel Highlands in Andaman would be called as Shahid Dweep, wherein the Havelock Island would be called as Swaraj Deep. So this is there, and all the three islands are the biggest tourism attracting spots. So there is one speciality of these three islands which has been put up in Andhra, that's Andaman and Nicobar. I'm very sorry about it. And when it comes to that, apart from that, you should also know that Mr. Prime Minister has inaugurated a slew of development projects as well, and he also has laid the foundation for several other related, that is like energy, connectivity, education, tourism, and also with respect to the health sectors. So here Mr. Azad Hind Fauj, where it is purely where he had addressed a public meeting at the Netaji Stadium on the occasions of the 75th anniversary of the hostage of the tricolor Mr. Bose. So as you know that Mr. Bose was the first Prime Minister of Azad Hind government, and he was also called as Subhas Babu, and he has made India's independence resolution to be more reluctant on the soil of Andaman. So he is also drawing in country's inspiration from Andaman as well, and that is why the government has now decided that the contribution to what he has made for India and also for the especially to the state of Andaman and Nicobar. Here he comes and gives a notification where he wants to proudly announce that year after the Rose Highlands would now to be called as Netaji Subhash Chandra Bose Dweeps. So this is about it. So this is a mixture of history and geography. So it plays a role of GS paper 1 of your mains examination and also for your preliminary examination, where the questions from Mr. Subhash Chandra Bose would be prominently seen in your prelims or in terms of your mains. And when it comes to geography, it is about the Andaman and Nicobar, which was earlier also there with respect to the percentage of the geographic nature in India and also the fauna and flora. And now it is a time where you have to know with respect to the islands which are being changed, and also with respect to the Sentinel Highlands, which is repeatedly there in the news with respect to the sentinels killing the person, Mr. John. So on lamlet of these are the three important occurrences to what had happened in 2018. So what one should know when it comes to Andaman and Nicobar, a possible question can also be seen in your prelims and mains examination. So try to focus more about the Union Territory, Andaman and Nicobar, as a becoming a very important aspect as of now. And this one, which talks on no agency has license to snoop. So this is basically with respect to the notification which was actually being listed, where they were stating that certain telecom service providers, they would only be able to ensure the authorized and designated agency where they would be able to intercept the communication, and also there won't be any misuse of the unauthorized agencies where they would be actually able to take out any informations. So basically they're saying that there are only 10 such agencies mentioned in the notification. They would be having the empowerment to intercept the electronic communication since 2011. So on lamlet of this is what now you have got the confirmation where the Union government has not given a blanket power to any agencies to intercept the information from any computers. So what they're saying is that to whatever the Union government is stating, that it is not given any of the powers for any of the agencies where they would be able to intercept the information from any of the computer. So here the agencies have to strictly follow to whatever the existing rules are being there. They're not supposed to change none of them. They have to carry out in such a way to what it has to be done. And they also say that there is no new rule or no new kinds of a law, no new procedures or no new agencies, no new blanket power or no blanket authorization is being given. It is the same law, the same rule, the same procedure and the same agencies, and they will not be able to get any of the extra blanket power when it comes to intercepting the information from any of the computers. So this has been, which has been listed out here. So this is all about getting that there is no change even in the comma or a full stop to what the existing rules and the regulations is being taken place. So this is all about it, where it is becoming a wider aspects when it comes to the data interpretations from one's computer. So the fewer interceptions to what they're saying is that there is a number of interceptions have actually gone since 2014. So the number of mobile phones have actually which has been connected has gone up around like 120 crore and the number of the electronic messages were also grown exponentially. So here this is an absolute number where the interceptions have actually gone down and the number of users have actually got increased. So either the interceptions have gone down, rather the connectivity has got increased more. The percentage of interception has gone down even furtherly is what it has been said. So basically the notification which actually talks on the agencies have been authorized for the purpose of the interception, monitoring and decryptions of any of the information where they would be able to generate the information, transmit, receive or store in any computer resource would be under the said act of section 69 of the IT, that's Information Act of 2000 part. So this is as per the Act of 2000. So this is what the confirmation to what the union government has been getting, that the no agency has a license to snoop in. So this is all about that one should know about the localizations and also with the data which has actually been breached in a larger aspect. So this is about it. Under the world column you had the big 10 to whatever happened in the year 2018. So the coverage has been out here. The one who are not really done with it, you can just glance this page, business column, as you have no much of the importance as well which has been given. Under page 13 you have this, the robust GDP growth to continue CII. So here the CII actually stands for Confederation of Indian Industry. So this is purely where it says that now India is also still continued to be the fastest growing major economy. So it's still continued, and the major thing where it has been expected that it will be a robust GDP growth through 2019. So this is what the CII had to say, and apart from that it also highlighted the strong drivers to through which it actually comes to into be a reality is through the service sector, infrastructure activity and the better demand conditions as well. So what they say is that the better demand conditions, let's say the GST is implementation or expansion with respect to growing investments in infrastructure, or having any of the positive effects of the reform policies which would be undertaken, or let's say it has been improved with respect to credit takeoff, especially in the service sector, would be standing at 24% will sustain the robust GDP growth in the range of 7.5% in 2019. So this is purely, these are the main factors which would be working. And apart from that, the CII has also identified the 7 key drivers where actually they would be encouraged in the growth in 2019, which would be where they are looking out to lowering the number of the GST rate slabs, and also they wanted to get in the IB, that is the insolvency the bankruptcy framework, to be more of blustering, and they wanted to simplify the business procedures, and at the same time they wanted to improve the agriculture productivity and among others. So here the CII has also suggested that these being the main key sectors, now it is high time that they wanted to lower the number of the tax slabs which has been there from a standard rate to a higher rate for a demerit goods, and also lower the rate for some of this mass consumption items. So whenever you know that the market is looking out for a mass consumption, that those kinds of a goods or a rate should actually go down. And apart from that, CSE is also having hopes where that they wanted the council to consider to extend the GST for some of the sectors like fuels, real estate, electricity and alcohol as well. And apart from that, they were focusing more to get on more as the additional benches of the NCTL, that is National Company Law Tribunal, to spread the geographically so that they would be able to get the things easier and faster with respect to the distressed businesses as well. And apart from that, the CII, that is a Confederation of Indian Industry, also said that the government should continue to place an high priority, and this is purely where they wanted to simplify the business procedures in 2019. And going forward, they also wanted to suggest that it is a high time that they wanted to be important, and it is best to get persuaded to the states where they wanted to implement on the agriculture, produce and the livestock market in the model system. That is the act. So they have to focus more on, because they are just like four states which has been implementing that agriculture, produce and the livestock marketing model act, but they wanted to make it for the other states as well. And moreover, they wanted to spur in as much as credit growth and improve the liquidity, so that the RBI would be having a better of the, you know, revisiting lending restrictions when it comes to the PCA, that's a prompt corrective action. At the same time, they would be able to have an opening up of a limited special liquidity window for all those emergencies of the financial institutions. So if they try to do all those things, then the GDP would be the robust where it will be continued as per the analysis to what the CII has actually done for India. And apart from that, you should also know that India can guard against the risk of higher oil prices by raising the domestic productions of the oil domestically, and also providing a special window for all the oil marketing firms where they would be able to procure the oil, and at the same time they would be able to step up their diplomacy with the US to continue secure the purchase from Iran as well. So this is something what they're trying to do. Even India can guard itself against any of the risk which has been associated with the oil prices, and also where it can also get a special window for all the oil marketing firms as part. So this is something where India would be continued to be as a GDP growth. So this is a, and here we have the bank like norms will hinder the NBFC growth. So we know that the NBFCs are under a high pressure as of now with respect to the liquidity crunch. So as of now, we know that the Island FS, which is an infrastructure leasing company, which is purely under the, you know, a lot of issues of the liquidity crunch, and there is also a possibility that would be pulling down the other big sectors as well, like the banks and the mutual funds and other sectors. So on limelight of it, now the Reserve Bank, which is actually coming up with as much as a tighter regulations on the non-banking financial companies, the firms are actually referring this to be as a shadow banks. So here they're telling that, and they've written a letter to the Prime Minister of India, Mr. Narendra Modi, suggesting that these kind of regulations to what the RBI is trying to put on the NBFCs will actually amper the growth of the sector as well. So here the regulations with are between the objective, and they have been aligning with that of the banks. So you should know the difference between the banks and the NBFCs. NBFCs are non-banking financial companies wherein the bank is a bank. So here they're saying that whatever the regulations are being right now are purely aligning that with that of the banks, because NBFC is not a bank, but they would be doing the similar work, but they will not be able to give any of the checks or the credit. No, DDs, that demand deposits. So here on lamlet of it, they're saying that here whatever the regulations has been coming on to the NBFCs as of now, it's keeping in mind that NBFCs is almost like a bank. So it is taking on a lines of the banks, and these kinds of an over regulations will actually make the NBFCs to be regulated like the banks itself, which will actually impart or hinder the NBFC growth altogether. So here what they're saying is that this is hampering the growth of the unique NBFC model, where it's completely different from that of the bank, and this would actually ensure that it will be, you know, lending which has successfully withstood the adverse scenarios like 2008 global crisis. So here they're saying that NBFCs is something of unique kind of a model, and this was been very successful that they would be able to overcome the 2018 global crisis and the recent liquidity crisis as well. This being the case, then why so many of the regulations which has actually been attracted on the NBFCs, and the entire issue whatever we are discussing right now has come to a limelight because last week the RBI had actually intended where it wanted to strengthen the asset liability management framework for the NBFCs. So this is purely on the lines of the bank, and which is harmonizing on it with respect to different categories of the NBFCs. So this is what which they have been completely understood that to whatever the RBI has been doing, it might hinder the NBFC growth. And you should know the certain facts is that to whatever the NBFCs are we talking right now, these NBFCs are around like 10,000 NBFCs which has actually been registered with the RBI, but the Reserve Bank of India has actually regulated this sector, where they have been grew with 15.18% in 2017. By the end of that, they could see almost with 19.8% of the scheduled commercial banks which have taken altogether. So this is purely on the balance of the sheet size to what they're saying. But one should, what one should know is that there are only 108 deposit taking NBFCs. So since only 108 of 10,000 which have been taking, so there is a huge difference as to what kind of an operation limit or the growth of NBFC should actually be talking on, because RBI is morely focusing on with an objective of securing the depositors' interest. So since the depositors are just with 110 of them under the NBFCs, why is the RBI trying to look at in such a, you know, way where it might hamper the NBFC growth is what the point is all about. And that is one of the reason why they have given a letter to the Prime Minister ensuring that to whatever the tightening regulation has been done by the RBI, it will definitely hamper the NBFC's growth. And apart from that, they also said that to whatever the applications from the NBFCs are trying, that the, any of the non-banking financial companies, if they wanted to get converted to a bank, they should be treated differently from any other applications for a banking license. So, it should not be under the same par to what they actually see the banks as well. So, this is one of the further suggestions to what they are actually given to what could be better ways that it could actually ensure that the NBFCs would go much better. So that anytime with respect to consuming or devastation can actually be lessened to a larger extent. So this is all about it. And NBFCs, we have discussed in the earlier past as well with respect to what is NBFCs, what are the main key roles about it. Since NBFCs have been repeatedly there in the news, it becomes highly important for us to know about the non-banking financial companies for the 2019 preliminary exam as well as for 2019 mains examinations as well. So this becomes extremely important for GS paper 3. So this is all about it. I'm moving on to page 14, which talks on business review. So here it is a trending upwards, which talks on the gross capital formation, which has actually increased in the recent months. So this is basically with rising due to the FDI. So that coverage you have with respect to what is it, and also the value of investment which was being announced by the manufacturing sector as well. And this one, the return of the native rice variety and the GST revenues stabilizing, compliance increasing, which is year end view, and micro factory can help recycle waste locally. So this is all a very minute news to what you have to know. So if you have, you are the ones who have to read this and you need to understand what is that trying to do. So I recommend you all to have a self reading, as this is self explanatory. And the more you read about these things, which means that you know how that you need to procure your answers. So producing purely comes from you. So I am giving it to you all. So you can just look on to them. Just have a cursory reading. That would be more than sufficient to understand what is the content in it. So on the page 18, we have this news which talks on the space probe nears the dark side of the moon. So this is basically with respect to the dark side of the moon. Why they call that is because the moon is actually, which is locked to the earth. So whenever there is a rotation, there would be a rotating at the same rate that it orbits our planet as well. So far, whatever the earth side view of the moon is there, it is only one sided moon, wherein the other side of the moon is never seen or witnessed by the earth. So there, that would be referred to be called as a dark side, which is never visible from the earth. So this is something where you need to know the fact, because both of them are at the rotating with the same rate that it actually orbits the planet. So on lamlet of it, now where the Chinese space probe is now making a position where it would be landing on the dark side of the moon for the first time. So now let's say if you're talking about the first half, which has been visible to be as a moon, on back side of that is what the Chinese space probe would be ending up, and that is called the dark side of the moon, and for the first time is what it could be seen. And the probe name is called as in Chang'e 4, which is entered into a planned orbit, and this is purely to prepare for the first ever soft landing on the far side of the moon. So this is something which you have to know. And here the China National Space Administration is the one which has been citing this to be as a, you know, kind of an a launch probe which they have taken, that's a Chinese space probe. So this is what you have to know. So and much earlier also, this Chang'e first entered the lunar orbit on December 12th. So this is the, which is brought to closest point just like 15 kilometers away from the surface of the moon. So it's as close as close now. And you should also know that this probe, to whatever we are talking right now, it has entered an elliptical lunar orbit at almost 8.55 Beijing times. So all these times would not be important for us. Just try to know about the moon and dark side. So if somewhere there is a question for a preliminary exam, so the dark side was always seen in news, what does it refer to? So try to get in, you know, get it right that this is, they're talking about the moon, which is the dark side where the earth would be only focused on to the one side of the moon. The other side is never seen. As always we say, you know, there are four lines which only one would be, three would be seen, the fourth one would always not be seen. Likewise, this is the, you know, the moon, only one side is seen, wherein the second side was not being seen. So now China is actually landing a probe, space probe, and which is called as in Chang'e 4. So that's it. These were the ones, and by this we have come to an end of the video. So these were the important articles for the day, and we hope this particular video would have helped you on your preparations. So work hard till you accomplish and do with the smart work. Thank you and have a very nice day.